It's my honor to come here to Philadelphia to the great Rani family, and I know you have a lot of activity here, and I already understood that great rabbis were sitting in this chair, so it obligates me at least not to bore you tonight. And I would prefer, if it's possible, that you would ask me questions, any questions you have, and like this I know I'm speaking about something that you have interest in. Otherwise, I will make a lecture, but if you have anything that you prefer to speak about, questions, doubts, things that bothers you, things you don't like, things you like, anything you want to bring up, we can make it like a discussion. That would be better. If not, then I'll force a subject on you. It's up to you. For those who do not know me, briefly, I give lectures mainly in Kiruv. Most of the time I speak to not religious people and prove to them that the Torah is divine. I've been doing it for more than 15 years. I guess about more than 4,000 lectures approximately. And, you know, I do it nationwide, overseas, Europe, Israel, and many, Baruch Hashem, with Hashem's help, many, many Jews who were living in a complete darkness, spiritual darkness, woke up. Some of them become fully religious, some of them partially religious. Some of them, Baruch Hashem, became rabbis already over the years. Some of them even Rashi Yeshivot from many years ago, serious people. The Gemara says in Pirkei Avot, Im en ani li mi li. If I won't take care of myself, nobody will do the job for me. It's true my children can help me after I move to the next world. It's true my tzedakah will help me. I put some tzedakah here and there. Things can happen from it. Trees are growing. One day you eat the food. It's all true. But in every second in our life, if you don't take care of yourself, nobody will do the job for you. Not even your wife. And we have to understand one thing. Everything in life has the opposite, which means you have white, you have black. You have merciful, you have cruel. You have generous, you have stingy. Everybody understands this is one thing, and that's the opposite. Allow me to ask you a question. What's the opposite according to the Torah? What's the opposite of Yerei Shamayim? Yerei Shamayim is a person who has fear from God. Not necessarily fear from the punishment. Ira has a double meaning. The word Ira in Lashon HaKodesh, it can be translated as fear. It can be translated as extra respect. When you yare, when irat kavod, you see somebody respectable, automatically you change your behaving right away, just being next to him. His presence in a place make you change your entire behaving because you understand a very respectable person is next to you. You don't yell, you sit different, you talk different. You know, you can call it put a show, but you recognize that somebody important is there. Obviously, when we say Ira, we mean HaKadosh Baruch Hu, we have a special Ira for him, obviously. But what's the opposite according to the Torah of Yirat Shamayim? Who knows?
Farah.
Odef Kavod, it's a proud person. It's come from pride. But what's the opposite of Yerei Shamayim? You may think, has no Yirat Shamayim. Yirat Shamayim, no Yirat Shamayim. But it's very strange because that's not what the Torah said. The Torah said like this. The Egyptians in Egypt, when Hashem brought the Aseret HaMakot, the 10 plagues in Egypt, the animals of the Egyptians were about to die. Moshe warned Pharaoh that that's what's going to happen. Some of the Egyptians knew if Moshe speaks in the name of Hashem, that's going to happen. It's just a matter of days. They made their animals go inside the houses and hid them inside their living room. And those animals survived. So the Torah says, Ele asher yaru et Hashem, those who feared Hashem, they hid their animals in. And what's those who their animals died? It's because they did not make their animals go into the homes. How did the Torah use? What word the Torah use for this kind of Egyptians who did not fear Hashem? It's very interesting. The Torah say, ואלו אשר לא שמו לב, those who did not pay attention, their animals died. So the ones who feared Hashem, they made their animals hide, and they got saved. Those who did not pay attention, why the Torah didn't say, those who didn't care about Hashem, those who did not fear God, their animals died. That's not what Hashem wrote in His Torah. Those who did not pay attention, paid the price. From here we learn the secret of life. Everything in life depends on this verse that I just mentioned. Everything, everything. Every second of our life connects to this word. You either yere shamayim, and if you are not, it's because you are distracted by nonsense. You are distracted by baseball. You are distracted by football. You are distracted by disco, by business, by, I don't know, all kinds of pleasures, all kinds of infatuations. If you are paying attention every second of your life, it elevates you and you are very connected to the Creator of the world. The more you are connected with Him, the greater your life becomes. In a spiritual way, we're not talking, yeah, to make millions makes you feel good. Oh, you don't have to worry about the bills so much. Your house becomes bigger, your clothing a little bit better. You know, there's some changes in a wealthy person's life. But connection with Hashem, even if you have trillions of dollars, He won't get it for you. Now, there are two kinds of righteous people. Righteous people who are glued to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, and you see it with their behaving every second of their life, whether they're on the street, whether they're in yeshiva, they're in a shul, they, you know, whatever they do, even they're sitting in a bathroom, even if they sit inside the bathroom, they have fear from Hashem. They behave in a certain way. They are not putting a show only when they're on the stage in front of a large room community. By then, everyone is religious. He has no choice. People would talk about him. It would ruin his children, shiduchim. The idea is to become Yerei Shamayim no matter where you are. If you are alone on the moon and you know nobody is watching you, you are alone. You can take off your shirt, you can behave in a certain way, nobody is watching. You can get up anytime you want. But you know Hashem is watching, that's called Yirat Shamayim. Not what the people say, this is Yirat of the people. The Ramban, Rabbi Moshe ben Nachman, one of the greatest rabbi ever lived in history, 750 years ago. Besides the fact that he was an unbelievable commentator of the Torah and on the Talmud, he was also an amazing Kabbalist, as an expert in Kabbalah, Torah Tasod. The Ramban wrote a book, a legendary book, that is affecting the Jewish world tremendously. It's called Sha'ar Agmul. What's this book is about? He's speaking about all the mystical things in Judaism that people like or hate, depend who you are. Some people like it very much, some people don't dare to touch it. What does it speak about? What's going to be when we leave this world? Heaven, hell, kafakela, Mashiach days. All these things that people are sometimes very interested to talk about. Sometimes they don't want to mention it, afraid to even talk about it. This is in this book. Many of the things we know about the afterlife comes from this book. Right in the beginning, in the first few pages, the Ramban wrote something that it's extremely surprising, extremely surprising. Every normal person that reads it is basically in shock. What does he write? And I know it's going to shock you as well, but prepare for this. This is what the Ramban said. Ramban said like this. There are rabbis, rabbis. Now when the Ramban used the word rabbis, we are not talking about rabbis in our generation. 750 years ago, one rabbi of his time was probably equal like 1,000 today in a spiritual level. So we are talking massive, knowledgeable rabbis. You know, not like today. Today you go, you make a test. After a few years of learning, yeah, that's it, you become a rabbi. If you're talented, you know how to speak, you don't even need to pass the test. The people would nominate you to be the chief rabbi of the world. They like how you give lectures, that's all. Or if you have a friend in a newspaper, in a religious community, he will make sure that everybody will know your name. Within 6 months, you're the chief rabbi of Israel. Everybody stand online to get a bracha from you. Why? You have somebody in the newspaper. It's your friend. He eats by you for Shabbos. He made you the second chief rabbi of the world. That's how it goes today. When a Ramban speaks, a rabbi, a head of a yeshiva, a head of a community, I promise you we are talking about a legit rabbi. This is what he writes. They are parnasim ha-memunim al ha-tzibur. People who are in charge of the community, the rabbi, the head of the community, whatever you want to call it. There are some of them, the Ramban speak about Jews, that have no share to the world to come, God forbid. We are talking religious Jews, not people who don't care about the Torah. We're not talking about these kind of people. People who comes to know, people who wants to know, people who wants to be tzaddikim. The Ramban speaks about this category of people. You know, obviously we know the whole list, people who deny the Torah is divine, or Moshe Rabbeinu made it up, or don't believe in Mashiach, don't believe in the afterlife. This is people who automatically cut themselves out. But there is another group of people which are falling in the same category, as shocking as it may sound. The Ramban writes, והפרנסים הממונים על הציבור, יורדים לגיהנום, they going חס ושלום to hell, ואינם יוצאים משם לעולם. They go there and they never ever come out of there. Even though they taught their community the way, the real way of the Torah and the mitzvot. They taught them Torah. They taught them Gemara. They taught them Shulchan Aruch. They told them what to do. And the people do everything that they taught them. But this kind of teachers, rabbis, head of communities, whatever you want to call it, cut themselves out of eternity because of one reason. Who knows what could be a reason that a person who taught Torah 30, 40, 50 years in his group, in his community, in his yeshiva, every day, daf yomi, after that, kollel, yeshiva, he may be the head of a school, high school, 400 students, people are everyone, black hats, you know, like a real yeshivish community. And in the end, chas v'shalom, the Ramban, don't say I said it, the Ramban writes, they have no chas v'shalom share to the world to come. How can it be?
They didn't pay attention?
They were fake?
No, we are talking people who taught real Torah. This is what you should do, this is what you should not do. Be careful from Lashon Hara. Be careful from Chilul Shabbos. Be careful. They taught everything. There is only one problem over there. One problem can cost us eternity. The people of that community, when they made their mitzvot, they did it, their intention was to satisfy this rabbi. They were worshipping him. He was the real God. Whatever you want to call him, the Rebbe, the Rosh Yeshiva, the teacher, whatever he was. Everybody feared him. Hashem was either not exist or secondary, chas v'shalom. Do you understand what we're talking here about? A person can be a robot, Shulchan Aruch 100% from A to Z. And in the end, when you put Hashem here and you put the big Rebbe next to him, who is he going to admire or to change his behaving with that Rebbe, but not in front of Hashem? Now, if it applies to a big Talmid Chacham to that, like I just described, by us it's needless to say. We don't have 1% of the knowledge of the people that Ramban speaks about. We are beginners. We just started. Some of us only keep Shabbos a month or two or whatever. It's better to get it in the beginning than to wake up 20 years later. I know many people like this, that they became Balei Tshuva, and after a few years they found out that the person who made them religious was fake. They found out. In our generation, unfortunately, there are many, many things like this that comes out everywhere you go. And as soon as they found that that person that they looked up to is fake, they left the religion. And I'm asking, what's the connection? I don't understand. If a crooked person on the street told you the right way to Philadelphia is make a right and go north, and you found out that in the end he has no idea about traffic, but he directed you to the right direction, and you're going to make a U-turn and go south? Just because you found out he doesn't know about traffic? What's the connection? Say, well, thank you. I got what I got from him. Now it's time to move on myself. Our job in life...
You saw it's
sheker. Yeah. No, but like I said, the fact that nowhere in Judaism it says that religion is based on the behaving of the Jews. Nowhere. Nowhere in Judaism there is any instruction, anywhere in a Talmud or in a Gemara. Yeah, there is to respect the Chachamim, to learn from their good things, the Shamesh Chachamim. We all know that. But nowhere in the Torah says you have to be religious like Moshe Rabbeinu. You have to be religious like Rabbi Akiva. Nowhere, the Torah didn't say it. First of all, there are many reasons for that. Hashem is not interested of imitators, people who copy what they see. Right? Many of the customs we have today, it was one machmir that made up a chumrah, and today it became all over the world. Why? Because one person did it, and the second one imitated him, and another one, and another one, and 30 years later, you have 500,000 people who does it, and really, it's not even Mi'ikar HaDin. Hashem didn't care if people would do it that way or that way. Why? People likes to copy each other. But the problem is that every one of us, the soul of every Jew has a different root. Not all Jews are equal. Some Jews connect to Hashem with love. Much, much higher level when you speak about wonderful things of Judaism. It makes them very inspired and they feel much closer to Hashem, and obviously you see right away a major impact on everyday life. Some people can connect to Hashem through fear. It's not a shame to say it. Most people in the world react to fear in a highway. If you say tomorrow the police in Philadelphia go on strike, no police on a highway, in a Jersey Turnpike. Do you know one car would drive slower than 70 miles an hour? One car, if you find that car, come tell me. Why people drive 60 there? Right? Because they're afraid this police is going to cost $300. Eventually you lose your license. Your insurance will be double. People understand immediate response. That's, by the way, one of the major reasons why we have so many not religious people in the world. Why? They ask the same questions, all of them. That's why I made this movie, Torah and Science. Besides proving that Hashem exists, and of course the Torah is divine, and showing that a person was unable to write such a book. And then in the third part, I begin to explain the purpose of life, you know, according to the legendary rabbis that we had, the Ramchal, the Ari, and all the other great names. Besides that, one of the reasons I made that CD, because I saw that everyone has mutual questions. Almost every secular person asks you the same questions. Which means the obstacle of getting close to Hashem is five or six things. You remove those five or six things, there's no more reasons for these people not to become frum. What are the five things? We don't care right now. One thing I should mention. People are understanding immediate response. Once they see immediate response, they convince that that's the truth. If they don't see an immediate response, they begin to have doubts, which means, this is a question that Moshe Rabbeinu asked HaKadosh Baruch Hu, even Moshe Rabbeinu that spoke to Hashem, asked that question, means it bothered him as well. Tzadik v'ra lo, rasha v'tov lo. How can it be? This Shomer Shabbos Jew, 20 years old, Chas v'shalom, is dying from cancer. And this Mechalel Shabbos murderer, who knows what he does, is 75, 95, whatever, making millions, celebrating, healthy, playing golf, age 90. And what's going on here? How can it be such a thing? That's what everybody asks, right? And I always answer this, and it's very simple. If the response of Hashem would be immediate response to everything we do in our life, for good or for bad, and the moment the world was created, it would be over that second. It would not survive 1 hour. Why? The whole purpose of this creation was one. A place of a test. School, college, university. What do you need it for? You gain knowledge, and in the end, what's the bottom line? You either pass the test and become a doctor, you fail the test and you become a cleaning guy. One of the two. You pass the test, you become a doctor. You don't pass the test, nobody cares. You went to university 18 years. Bottom line, you got your doctorate or no? You didn't? I'm very sorry. But I went to college 18 years. My friend only 5 years. But your friend passed the test. The Torah says, "Ki menaseh Hashem etchem." I'm testing you. What? Twice it says it in the Torah. "Ki menaseh Hashem etchem." One time it says, "I'm testing you." What? To see what's in your heart. Lirot et asher bilvavcha. What? Atishmor mitzvotayim lo. Are you going to follow my Torah and mitzvot? You keep my mitzvot or not? That's one place. In another place it says, to see, I'm torturing you. Leman anotcha. Anot, inui, means giving you hard time. What's in the end? What's in the end of that? Lehativcha ba'acharitecha. To reward you in your end. If somebody ever asks you, where does it say in the Torah there's life after life? Today it was proven scientifically already. Just today someone sent me an email, 5 minutes movie, of a goy kid, baby, 2 years old, is starting to describe to his father all the airplanes of the American Air Force. He was an American pilot in a war against Japan. Before the atomic bomb, probably a month before, or whatever it was. And his plane crashed and he died. Now he's 2 years old, he comes to his father, this is F-18, this is F whatever the names of the planes, and he described everything. Then they took him to a place where the jet airplane's there, and his mother said, "Oh, look, there's a bomb here." He said to his mother, "He's a little kid." "No, it's not a bomb, it's an oil tank." What do you see? Then they begin to talk to him. Every time a plane is passing through the room, he goes under the table and hold his hand. So they ask him, "Why are you afraid like this?" He said, "What do you see every time the plane say?" "I see a little man is crushed inside the plane." And then, I didn't even finish this thing because I already saw hundreds of films like this of different people all over the world. This is people who remember their previous life without hypnotizing them. All of us can know our previous life with hypnosis. People that knows how to do it, they hypnotize you, a Jew, a non-Jew, parapsychologist who knows how to do it. It's called regression. It takes you back on time, and it can take you to 1920, let's say. And that's obviously before we were born. And all of a sudden, you begin to talk in a language that you don't speak today. Imagine we speak French now. I don't speak French. In a video, they show you yourself, that were born in Israel or in the United States, speaking a language you don't understand a word. Then you see the video and you say, "What am I saying?" So you're saying that you live in Paris, and you are this and you are that, and you describe everything like it's live. What is it? What's going on here? Everything a person ever did in his history. History means in all his reincarnations. None of us are new here. It's very, very rare that in this generation there are new souls. They asked the Stipler, the father of Rav Chaim Kanievsky, which is a very, very big Talmid Chacham in Bnei Brak, if there are any new souls in this generation, he said hardly. All of us are people who were here in different bodies. The fact that we are here in the 21st century, it's not an honor for ourselves. It's an indication that all of us, excuse me for saying it, all of us, include myself, are, in a way, we are losers. We fail many, many times in our test. And that's why Hashem said, well, instead of crying, you're laughing. Yeah. What does it mean? What does it mean? It means that if we were righteous already, we don't have to come here again. And another test, and another 70 years, and another 70 years. That means we corrected everything in our previous life. We have nothing to do here. The fact that we are still here, we still have to keep Torah, mitzvot, musar, tefillin, tzedakah, working on our midot, that means we did not finish our job. Now I want to explain a little bit how it works. You take three little children, and you give them a big bag of pretzel, 2 years old, each one of them. And you come to the first one and ask him, "Give me one." He doesn't want. "No, give me one, I just gave you the whole bag." "No, if you take one, what will happen?" "It will call 911. The whole house is rocking, screaming, rolling. Then you come to the second one, he gives you one. Then you ask another one, he already makes face. Third one, he begins to cry. By the fourth one, he's also rolling. So now we have two are rolling on the floor. Then you come to the third one, you give him the bag of pretzel, you ask him for one, he takes one or two and he gives you the whole bag. And he doesn't care. He took one or two to himself and he gave you the bag. Now we have to ask, if we are people who pay attention, me'ayinim al ha'chaim, that's the Ramchal say, person has to be me'ayen. Me'ayen means deeply, paying attention very, very carefully to everything happens in general and in your private life. If you don't pay attention to every little detail of your life, there's no way to find the right direction. The Ramchal said there are two kinds of people that lives in the darkness. He lives in the darkness and he lives in the darkness. So why he nominate them as two different categories? It's both in the darkness. One just found out that they live in the darkness. They found out today. They came to a seminar. They watched Torah and Science film full of proofs. Oh, every moment of my life was a big mistake. I'm heading to the opposite direction. Now, what's the difference between those two? The one who found the truth right now looks much more depressed than the other one. The other one smoking cigar, driving to play golf. Both of them are sick. Both of them are going to die in a month. One of them found out that he must get chemo or treatment or surgery, who knows what. And he has a 10% chance to get saved. But he has to take some major steps. And the other one is happy, you know, everything is fine by him. Looking at them, wow, look at this depressed guy, poor guy. What kind of life he have? In reality, who is luckier? The depressed one. Why? He's been saved as we speak. Maybe yes, maybe not, but at least he has a chance. If a person found the truth, he has a chance to correct his life. If he didn't find the truth, how exactly he will correct his life? You know how many millions of American Jews live in America have no idea who is Moshe Rabbeinu? Maybe once in their life they heard about him, accidentally in a conversation, or Noach. You know there are Israelis in Israel today, they don't know who Noach is. You ask them, tell me, do you know who Noach is? The Teva, the Mabul? What's that? They ask kids in Israel, more than half of them didn't know who Rabbi Akiva is. So the one from Lag BaOmer, how many years he lived? 60 years ago? Israeli teenagers. They have no idea. They don't know who Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai is. You tell them the word Shulchan Aruch, they say, what is it, a cookbook? They think, Shulchan Aruch, cookbook. They don't understand. They don't know. You know how many times I go to give lecture in a certain place, there's a big library over there full of books, and there are many, many people, even more than here, Baruch Hashem, and every time I ask each one of them, after they participating in many lectures already, can you bring me the Rambam from the shelf? And I, of course, show them where the Rambam is. All the way to the right, third floor. And there's about 20 books. And he's standing there 5 minutes, and he cannot find the Rambam. He cannot even find the book. He has no idea what Rambam is. He looks around, look at the book like it's Chinese book. He has no idea. If you ask him to open it, forget it. And they never open a holy book in their life, these people. And this is the majority of the Jewish people in the world. We are 13.2 million people in the world. Most of them have no idea what they live for only one reason. We didn't have the ability to reach them yet. Because it's a game of number. I'll give you an example. If a company sells a special product, I don't know, they made a special diaper for the babies, something very extra special. If they reach 1 million people and 100,000 of them bought, which means 1 out of 10 bought, and then next month they also reach 1 million people and also 100,000 bought, and after 2 years they know their statistic is 10% success. They send advertisement to 1 million people, they get 100,000 customers. By now they can tell you how much they're going to make this year, and all the analysts already can tell you next year how much the value of the stock is going to be, based on the statistics, surveys. What's the difference between these two Judaism? It's exactly the same concept. If we see that 100 people that we give this CD, 4 hours Jewish seminar, for every 10 of them, 2 or 3 becomes eventually in 3-4 weeks Shomer Shabbat. which means it's a third of the people. It's not that you fell with the other two-thirds, because they didn't believe in Hashem, now they know Hashem is here. They didn't believe in the Torah, they also now that know the Torah is real. They didn't believe in the afterlife, now they know for sure it exists. They didn't believe in the oral Torah, now they know for sure it's divine. The fact that you don't see them became religious doesn't mean it didn't affect them. Sometimes it will happen 2 or 3 years later. Sometimes 10 years later they'll have a tragedy, or they get fired, or they get divorced, and then they remember everything that they recorded in their subconscious. For sure you reach some kind of success. So if we didn't get to all these people, what does it mean? That something is wrong in our system. The religious community should have done more to reach these people, to reach them, to invite them, to direct them to the right lectures. The fact that we did not do so, we are failing every day in a mitzvah, Hochiach tochiach et amitecha. Hochiach tochiach et amitecha is an obligation to every Jew. There's many other mitzvot, ואהבת לרעך כמוך, לא תעמוד על דם רעך. Right? If you see the donkey of your Jewish friend collapse with his weight, you cannot ignore and pretend you don't see. You wear an expensive suit. Tough luck. You have to go, put your bag away, and now help him to take whatever the bags and help the donkey get up. So Chazal say, if the donkey, what's a donkey? Compare a donkey to a soul of a Jew. If the donkey you have to feel sorry for, and you have to lift him, and you cannot ignore him, your brother, your cousin, your neighbor, that chas v'shalom cutting themselves from eternity, you can ignore them? It's needless to say, it's kal v'chomer. Going back to our three babies, what happened? Nobody ever educated these kids. They never went to kindergarten yet. They didn't go to school. They don't know anything yet. What made these kids understand that one of them does not want to give you even one pretzel, and the other one is willing to give you 2, 3, and the third one is giving you the whole bag? One is very, very generous, and one is very, very stingy. What's happening here? The answer is, we have to understand this, because many people, some of them even learn in yeshivot, they don't understand this concept. This concept is that the baby that is very generous, few years ago died, 70 years old, somewhere in the world, he died. And his soul went up to the court of heaven. And he had a trial. We say Kaddish for the deceased people for 1 year. The Gemara said that the Mishpat is 12 months. So, we hope to help these deceased people, our fathers, our mothers, brothers, whatever. That's why we say 12 months Kaddish. So, he passed his test. And now Hashem sent him back in a different body. The same person in a different box. The box looked different. He used to be 6 feet tall. Now he's 5'5". His nose used to be long. Now it's short. His eyes was brown. Now it's blue. Doesn't matter. The box is, it's $2. The body of a human being by the chemist, it's $2. That's it. Less than a slice of pizza you ate here before. Put the body of Albert Einstein, a famous person, $2. Pizza costs more. Nobody ever sue for the body. Everybody understands the value of the person. It's a spiritual value. That's why when a homeless person who sleeps in a park died with a car accident, assume he has a son somewhere, how much they sue for? Not that much. But if the president of the United States got hit by a car, oh, now they want a lot more. The insurance is much more, because the value of a person, same thing in a Gemara. If you damage a Jew and you damage a different Jew, we have to evaluate his level. The higher his spiritual level is, the more you pay. Why? Same thing a woman. If a woman is extremely modest, she never been with a man, she has a value. If she was already, she made a sin one time in her life, her value cut by 50%. There is evaluation, spiritual evaluation. There are evaluations of different race. If it wasn't in the Torah, then we have no permission to say it. Then we become like Hitler. What's the difference? He's a racist and we are a racist. But if the manufacturer of all mankind say that these goyim are more than the other goyim, those goyim are worse than the other goyim, this goyim you should respect, this goyim you don't owe them anything. This goyim, if they want to convert, they can convert. This kind of goyim, if they want to convert, they can never convert. What do you see? There's different levels of nation, different level of race. The kid that is 2 years old that he died, Hashem sent him back to life. Since he was generous in his previous life, he was a real major Baal Tzedakah, he gave millions to Tzedakah. Every rabbi who came to him, he was welcoming him with great smile and writes a generous check. Always, everybody knew this is a major Baal Tzedakah. When he passed away, since he has other problems, Hashem sent him back to continue from where he stopped his test. Hashem changed the atmosphere around him. For instance, let's say he was a person who makes sin with his body. He went and makes sins. He wasn't a modest person. Now, since he still has this test, Hashem reincarnate him in a handsome body. Why? If it would be very ugly, then there's no point of test, because anyway he cannot do anything. Now Hashem was interested that he will become extremely handsome. Why? Because that's his test. If a person's test is to give tzedakah, Hashem makes him very rich. Why? If he will be very poor, where is the test? You didn't give tzedakah. Thank you, Hashem. I have $200. That's my total value. How would I give tzedakah? I cannot pay anything. I was living from Tomchei Shabbos. How exactly do you want me to give tzedakah? Ah, but if I have $200 million, now I understand. Hashem is expecting me to support Talmidei Chachamim, to support Tshuva, to support widows, obviously. The same thing here. If you see a kid very, very angry, 2 years old, he didn't see anyone he's angry at. He just came to the world. You take a candy from him, he scream, he throw things at you. You cannot stand next to him. Very violent, angry kid. Why? He died like this. The other one is very calm down, very polite. Not, he takes, here, take, no problem. Why? He died like this. The weaknesses that we did not correct, we came back to the world with them. We learn it from the story of Moshe, Rabbeinu, and Yitro. Chazal say, Cain and Hevel were two brothers. The first murder in a creation had few reasons. One of the reasons, there are few reasons brought in Chazal, one of the major reasons is jealousy. Cain was born with one twin, very, very pretty girl. She was his sister, and he lived with her. Because remember, that was before the Torah was given. The laws that we have in the Torah, it's prior to that. And Hevel was born with two twins, two female sisters. Cain is jealous that Hevel have two wives, and he has only one. That's one of the reasons who brought him in the end to murder Hevel. About 2,400 years later, believe it or not, Hashem has a lot of patience. This whole world is 6,000 years. 2,400 years later, Hashem decided that now it's time for Cain to correct his sin. 2,400 years later, what does he do? He made Cain reincarnated in a new body. The body of that person called Yitro. Yitro is Cain. And it sent Hevel back to the world as Moshe Rabbeinu. But since a soul is not a spirit, it's not a physical thing. If you take, this napkin and you cut it in the middle, what happened? Up to now it was 10 inches. Now it's 2 pieces, 5 inches each. You cut it again, it's 2.5 inches. You cut it again, 1.25. The more you cut it, in the end, there's nothing too old. You need a microscope to see it. Physical thing, the more you cut, the smaller it gets. A divine soul, it's an energy, it's no material. You can cut it to 1,000 pieces, and each piece is the same as the other one. It's no different, it's like fire. You can take a candle and light 1,000 candles from it. It won't take away from the fire here. The fire is still the same. The more you take, no problem. Anything else that you take, you make it smaller and smaller. A soul of a person can be reincarnated in few different bodies. Since he has many things to correct, some of the soul can go into this body to correct anger. That part of the soul go into this body to correct generosity. Some to correct murder. How do we learn it? Besides the Shara Gilgulim of the Ari HaKadosh, we learn it from Cain. A part of Cain's soul went into the body of Yitro. The other part of his soul went into the Egyptian man that Moshe Rabbeinu killed. Why Hashem put Cain in two different bodies in the same generation? Because now it's payback time. Now it's time to purify the soul of person called Cain. So, since you murder Hevel because of a woman, your correction will be to serve him with a woman. Yitro comes to Moshe and gives him Zipporah, his daughter. I'm even with you on the female subject. But there's still a problem. I killed you. I spilled your blood. What happened? I will get killed by you. When Vayar Moshe et HaMitzri, Vayach Moshe et HaMitzri. He said the name of Hashem, Shem HaMforash. The Egyptian fell and died. The story of Cain and Hevel was corrected 2,400 years ago. Mordechai and Esther, hundreds of years of difference from the generation of Shaul until we arrived to Mordechai and Esther and the story of Haman. And Chazal said this is a continuation of the story who happened in the time of Shaul. Shaul is cashing on his merit that his grandchildren are Mordechai and Esther, which are cousins. Why? Because he was a modest person. To be modest wasn't just to dress like the Baba Sali, that you cannot see one hair of your body. It's important, mainly for women. To be modest means to live a modest lifestyle. We have in Judaism three covenants that we made with HaKadosh Baruch Hu. All three of the covenants appear in one word in Judaism, the word Shabbat. Shabbat, in the word Shabbat, Shin, Betaf, you have three covenants, Shlosha Britot, Shalosh Britot. Shin is Shabbat, Bet is Brit Milah, Taf is Tfilin. What's special about these three mitzvot? There are 613 mitzvot. But three of them are exceptional, are extra special. Why? Why the
foundation.
Yeah, why the extra special? Because those three mitzvot HaKadosh Baruch Hu called Ot. Ot I beni uvenechem. It's an agreement, it's a sign between me and you that we are connected. Shabbat, ושמרו בני ישראל את השבת, לעשות את השבת לדורותם ברית עולם, ביני ובין בני ישראל, עוד אי לעולם. Between me and the nation of Israel, it's a sign for eternity. What about תפילין? והיה לאות על ידיך. It's a sign on your hand, which means on the heart, and on the brain, or in between the eyes. This eye start right here, and this eye start right here. And that's why the tefillin is right here, because the eyes are really here. What you see here, it's the blinds. There's a pipe that the vision goes through it. It's like the windows. If you close the blinds, then I cannot see what's outside. I am the soul, this room is the body, and these windows are the eyes. If you close the blinds, it's the eyelashes are down. If you open the blinds, the eyes are open. But if I'm gonna come out of that room to the street, I have no more limitation. When I'm inside the body, I can only see to one direction, where the front of the body. But when the soul comes out of the body, the soul can see to all four directions at the same time. There's no more limitation of distance, of hearing, of traveling from one place to the other. People who died clinical death and came back to life, Jews and non-Jews, they reported all the incident of their accident in details, everything that happened in the highway when the body was there, and then when the body arrived to the hospital, 10 minutes after they came back to life, and they opened up their eyes in the hospital, and they were able to describe two different scenes. What happened in the ambulance all the way from the highway to the hospital, and at the same time, when they were in a hospital, they were able to describe the hospital and the place of the accident at the same time. Sometimes pieces of their body were in the highway, and later they found it and brought it into the hospital, like a guy in Israel. They brought his jaws in a ball. They don't know what to do with that. They found it, it came out of his body from the accident. They put it in a ball and they brought it into the hospital. All that time, when he came back to life, he was able to describe everything that happened in a highway which is miles away. And at the same time, every room in a hospital. Why? The soul has no limitation. Chazal already said to us that a person is where his mind is, not where his body is. You can be sitting in this room and your mind is in your business meeting that you have tomorrow. That's where you are. A person can lay on a beach in a very quiet place. He has a private beach, windy, nice day, sunny. He hears the noise of the waves, you know, and everything, and then get a heart attack and die. Why? He was listening in his headphones to a fight that he had 20 years ago in Vietnam, or 30 years ago, whenever it was. And he heard people screaming and they got shot, and his best friend is dying and he listens to it. It was recorded. And while he was listening to it, he got a heart attack. From the tension, he got a heart attack, and they wrote in his death certificate the reason of death, laying on the beach in Acapulco. That's what they write, no? What was the reason of death? He was laying on a beach. In reality, he died in Vietnam. You understand? Same thing when a person has in mind, irure avera kashim min avera. Thoughts of the sins are worse than the actual sin. Why? The actual sin has limitation. It started at 5 o'clock, it finished 5:10. And it's over. The sin is over. Thinking about it can take years. There's no end to it. There's no end in the imagination of the person how he contaminates his neshama by thinking. Everything a person ever saw in all his different bodies recorded in a soul, what we call today subconscious. We have conscious, we have subconscious. Everything is recorded. If a parapsychologist hypnotizes a person today, he is able to tell him things from his previous life in small details. I give you an example. I always like to use this example. A person came from work, 6 in the evening. He got off the bus and he began to walk towards his apartment. His wife is standing in the kitchen and watching her husband walking towards the house. She sees that her husband did not pick his head from the floor. It's like reviewing everything on the floor. When he entered the house, she said to him, "Darling, can you describe to me all the objects you saw on the floor all the way from the bus stop to here?" So he said to her, "What happened to you? Are you crazy? Who cares about what's on the floor? I didn't look at anything on the floor." She said, "You did not pick your head for 1 second. You reviewed everything on the floor. You cannot describe to me what you saw." He said, "No, I was thinking about what happened at work. I was really here, but I wasn't here." 5 minutes later, she wants to hang a picture on the wall. She's looking for a nail or a screw in a drawer. She cannot find it. She said, "Wow, I cannot find the nails." He said, "Oh, wait, I saw a nail on the street. Let me go get it for you." He ran quickly. She looks from the window. He comes next to the bus stop. He pick up a nail from the floor. He runs and he serves her with a nail. So she said to him, "I don't understand. 5 minutes ago I asked you, can you tell me what you saw on the floor? You couldn't say anything. Now you remember a nail? Such small nail on the floor?" "Of course. Everything you ever saw in this life, in your previous life, in the previous, all the way to the neshama of Adam, from the time it split, everything is recorded. Every beep, every car on the street who beep, every guy who cares, every not modest woman on the street, everything you ever looked at or heard, it's all recorded. That's why the Torah is so strict. Lo taturu achre levavchem v'achre enechem asher atem zonim. Watch your eyes. In Judaism, there's a very, very serious obligation to watch what goes into your head. How does it go in? Through the eyes or through the ears. That's why you have to block your ears. When someone speaks Lashon Hara, you don't want to hear. When someone cares, you want to block your ears. If you see something you're not supposed to see, you close your eyes right away. You turn your face, etc. Even to smell bad things, even to smell, it's affecting the soul. This is all spiritual food who either elevate the soul or destroy the soul. And even if a person made tshuva, he became extremely religious, if you hypnotize him, you see that while he's in hypnosis situation, he doesn't aware of what he's saying. They take all the information from his subconscious and he describes a non-modest woman walking in the street. He looked at her 40 years ago. It's all recorded. There's no way to erase it. And all these things affecting our behaving, we sometimes don't know. Sometimes the same thing, that kid that I told you today, this pilot, every time a plane passed by, He goes under the table. Why? He leaves the war. It's still affecting him. He remembers his previous life with his conscience. We don't remember who he used to be, because this is an exception to the rule. But in a place of hypnosis, we know everything. We can speak in different languages. We can tell you everything. It's very interesting. For instance, people who got shot and they got killed in their previous life, they're born sometimes with a birthmark exactly where the bullet entered the body. It's very interesting. There are some goyim in Africa, in Europe, that they remember how they died in their previous life. They got shot. And today they have a birthmark exactly where the bullet entered. Why Hashem did it, I don't know. Why it was important to send a hint, I don't know. But we see there's a direct connection. So now remember, sometimes a person becomes Baal Tshuva and he say to the rabbi who makes him religious, Rabbi, this I can do, this I can do, this, please don't make me do it. I can't, it's too much for me. But everyone should know, how do you know your real purpose in life? The hardest thing for you to do, that's the main reason why you are sent back to this world. If a woman has very difficult time to dress modestly, it's easy for her to keep Shabbos, it's easy for her to eat kosher, she's extremely kosher, she's very generous, she gives donations, she makes great brachos, she reads Tehillim, she's a great mother, she raised the children to Yiddishkeit. But when she walks on the street, her wig is not exactly modest, and her clothes are too tight, and open, and cuts, and this, and all kinds of bad things about it. And it's very difficult for her to change, especially when the environment today is very dirty. The harder the environment gets, the harder for the individual to change. A person is a product of his society. The society affects each one of us. It designs our accent. It designs some of our behavings. It designs certain things about us. Why? Because we grew in a certain neighborhood. We grew in a certain family. That's why I give you an example. If a father said to his son, when someone called, I'm not home. Somebody is looking for him. And he says, shh, I'm not home. And then he speaks to his son 5 hours a day to stop lying. Why are you lying so much? Why are you lying? You're not good. Midvar sheker tirchat. It won't help. Because one picture equals like 1,000 words. Every day, see, I'm not home, I'm not home. That's it. What are you fooling me? Telling me you should not lie. Every one of your problems you try to solve with lies. This is how we grow. So that's affecting him. And many other things. Violence, for instance. Yes, I know some rabbis hundreds of years ago say that sometimes it's positive to punch the kids. Definitely not today. Every father who hit his children for sure make them get off the derech. 100%, you see what's happening today. Because as soon as they become independent, they take revenge against them. Kids can manage on their own today with Facebook, internet, all kinds of organizations that put places for them to sleep. As soon as they feel independent, they kick the religion, they kick the Yiddishkeit, they don't want to hear anything from it. Thank you. And some of the things that used to be relevant hundreds of years ago are not relevant today. For instance, I give you an example. Some rabbi said, don't be too strict with your children. Let them watch sport a little bit. You gotta feed the Yetzer Hara a little bit. If you say everything not allowed, everything not allowed, what happened to these kids? Then they rebel against everything. Against Shabbos, against Tefillin, against Davening, against everything. That could be true with some kids. That could be a disaster with other kids. I know 2 kids that the father took the advice of the Rosh Yeshiva, and those 2 kids became goyim in 1 year. Why? First time they saw in the internet a baseball game, that was the end of their life. Why? They saw on the side all kinds of pop-ups, commercial, picture of a woman all of a sudden, a window opening, advertisement opening, and that attracts their attention. Wow, there's a whole world up there. Now remember, this is not mature people who already lived in a nonsense lifestyle. They are sick and tired of this kind of life, and they want to make tshuva. So it's going to be very difficult to them to convince them to return back to their bad ways. Why? They are so disgusted from this secular lifestyle. They want to purify their soul. So they are not in such jeopardy. But these kind of innocent kids, they are so curious. The smarter they are, the more curious they are. The more dangerous the situation is. It's enough that one time they saw an electronic device, and that's the end of it. Now they're going from yeshiva, lunch break, they go to the pizza shop, to the store that sells television, that stands by the window, next thing, and that's how it is. And you destroy them by showing them animals in the Discovery Channel. Rabbi, what? We show them cartoons. What's cartoons? Cartoons is full of violence. What do they teach the kids in cartoons? First, dirty language. The goyim don't hold that it's dirty, but for us it's very dirty. Second, violence. In almost all the cartoons, they show a hero and a loser. And how you become an important person? By breaking the head of the loser, no? Wasn't it? That's the way we grew up. Popeye, this, he takes spinach, next thing he sends the guy to, who knows, to the moon. And how the kids go, everyone walks in the street and make all kinds of things, like it's Bruce Lee or Popeye, no? And that's in his genes already. And that's how the kids grow up. You show them, I don't know, wrestling, this thing. He takes his little brothers. All of a sudden, you come home, you see, 2 years old, kid on the chandelier from the second floor. Abba, take me down. Why? Yesterday, watch. That's it. It takes away all his free choice. The idea is like this. To pay attention to every detail of our life, it's still no guarantee we'll be righteous. Because a person has a free choice. One person had an accident and he broke his two legs. And his friend next to him also broke his two legs. The first one say, oh, Hashem, how great you are. How you saved my life. The other person say, Hashem, why are you so cruel to me? It's not fair, there's no justice. That's it, I'm done with you. Finished. What happened? One guy, he make a meal in a shul, Birkat HaGomel, Seudat Hodaya, bring whiskey, bring L'chaim, Kugels. And the other one went to the beach. Why? Free choice. One chose to do the right thing, one chose to do the wrong thing. Same incident. Saved this guy's life. You know, one guy came to the shul, and he brought a kiddush. They asked him, what's the occasion? Mazel tov, mazel tov. He said, no mazel tov. Nothing was born to me. So, okay, so what's the occasion? A week ago, I crossed the street, and a car came and hit me, and it was a very serious accident, and Baruch Hashem, a week after, I'm out of the hospital, and I'm okay. One or two surgeries, Baruch Hashem, I'm able to walk, to talk. Big miracle. So I'm making seudat hodaya to Hashem. Everyone, Baruch Hashem, Yishtabach Shmo, beautiful. The next day, I see another guy from the minyan, also brings kiddush. He set up the table. So, what accident you had? Anything happened to you? He said, no, Baruch Hashem, nothing. So, what's the occasion? He said, 20 years I'm crossing this street every day and no car hit me. It's not a reason to say thank you to Hashem only after an accident. This is a person who pays attention to life. You know, in the time of the Holocaust, it was very difficult to put tefillin because the Nazis took everything. Here and there was one Jew smuggled either tefillin shel Rosh or both of them to the camps, and everyone used the same pair of tefillin. There used to be Rabbi Silver from Cincinnati. I believe he passed away, but I'm not sure. And he, you know, was the head of a community. And one Shabbat, he see one of his minyan members have a guest. A 70-something years old Ashkenazi man. He comes into the minyan. He takes a sidur. He knows where to daven. He knows Musaf. He knows Torah when they take the Torah. He knows how to behave. And, you know, end of the davening, he takes his yarmulke off. He put it in a box and he's about to leave. Rabbi ran quickly to him. Good Shabbos, Shabbat Shalom, no. He said, I noticed that you know all the halachot. he said, and he speaks to him in Yiddish. The old man answered the rabbi back in Yiddish. He said, not for sure. So what happened? He used to be four? I said, yeah. And that's it? He said, that's it, I'm done with him. So he said to him, what happened? He said, if you would see what I saw in the Holocaust, believe me, you also leave the religion. So the rabbi told him, I know many Holocaust survivors, they became even more religious after the war. What made you think that that's it? So he said, we used to stand every day, the Nazis used to come 5:30, 6 in the morning, we stand online, and they send us to work. Some days they didn't have work for us. There was no work. They finish what they have to do, so they're not going to let us sleep. So they bring us to the sun, and they make us stand 17, 18 hours a day. And one slice of bread all day you eat. That's it. And you stand like this. You're not allowed to move. You're not allowed to eat. Nothing. You have to stand like this. And very, very skinny people. They're very dizzy. Every few hours, one of them collapses. Cannot stand anymore. If you look at him, they shoot at you. He's describing what happened. You're not allowed to move. One person just fell, they shoot him. You're not allowed to look down. Your best friend just died, you're not allowed to look. Sometimes this to make them stand naked. Imagine, you stand and your Rosh Yeshiva stand naked right next to you. Or the wives right there, they all stand over there. It's horrible, mental torture. It wasn't only physical torture. So he said, I was standing one line in front of my friend. My friend is behind me. And my friend said to me, Fischel, it's almost Shkia, 5 minutes to sunset. So I whisper, what do I care now, Shkia? 17 hours I'm standing, my knees are about to fall apart. He's talking to me about Shkia. So my friend said, we didn't have a moment to put a tefillin today. All day we didn't get a chance yet to get to that tefillin. There's a tefillin hidden somewhere. That's all he thinks about. From 5 in the morning that they made them stand, today they came extra early. All day he's thinking, will I be able to put my tefillin or not? Even though it's completely patur. Anus Rachmana Patre. Kadosh Baruch Hu dismissed a Jew that is unable to do a mitzvah. It's not his fault. That's it. It counts like he did it. Ma'ale ani alav ke'ilu asao. I'm giving him reward like he actually did it. Why? Because I know he wanted to do it. He wasn't able to. He says, there was one old man in a camp that had one pair of tefillin. That's it. He smuggled it. But he did not let us put tefillin for free. We had to pay him with something. Either a potato or a piece of bread or a cigarette. Anything you had, you make a deal with him. How many times you'll be able to put a fill in for this cigarette or for that potato? This is how they are. Now remember, this was a manager of a bank. This is a big brain surgeon. This is a judge. This is all. Who are the Ashkenazi Jews in Germany or in Europe? A lot of business people, owners of department store, owners of real estate, big doctors, big lawyers, just like in America. Very successful Jews. Beautiful mansion, $10,000 chandeliers in every room. One day they took them out of the room and put them, some of them hid in a sewer for 3 years. A family of wealthy Jews, they were billionaires. They lived in a sewer with their kids for 3.5 years. All the bathroom of the Germans went on their head every day. 3.5 years inside the bathroom until they survived and wrote their book. This is what happened. So the old man doesn't want to let them put tefillin for free. You got to give them something. There was another old man that is completely broke. He has nothing to offer. So he asked the owner of the tefillin, listen, you got everything I ever had. There's nothing I can give you anymore. Nothing. I left with nothing. No bread, no cigarette, no nothing. Let me put tefillin. He said to him, I'm sorry. If I let you put for free, everyone will want for free. I'm sorry. Business is business. So now this guy, his name is Fischel. He said, Rav Silver from Cincinnati in a shul. He said, Rabbi, after I saw that, I decided that religion is all business. I took off, I didn't have yarmulke, but I done with Hashem. That moment I decided no more. Finished. Rabbi Silver from Cincinnati told him, you're foolish Your ears should listen to your foolish mouth. Hundreds of Jews sacrificed their life. 5 o'clock, winter, summer, they got up half an hour early, stood online, gave the last piece of bread they stole here and there from the kitchen, just not to miss one day of tefillin. One day, even though they are dismissed, they don't have to keep. They didn't want to lose one day. You did not learn any Musar from them. Only from that wicked old man you learned everything and you left Hashem. Who are you telling stories? And that man, in one moment of his life, this is, we're talking years after the war, he made a turn in his switch in his head. And he started to cry in front of the whole shul. You know, everyone is listening. And he said, Rabbi, you're right. It's all excuses. You're right. And he said, it's not too late. He's still alive. It's not too late. No. Return today. As long as you breathe, you can still correct. It's true. All the years that you did not keep mitzvot are gone. Nobody will pay you for Shabbat because you did not keep Shabbat. Nobody will pay you for tefillin if you didn't put 30 years. But at least you get saved of all the punishment. At least you have a share to the world to come. Maybe you have a chance to be reincarnated in a better environment. Your father will be a big rav. You will be born in a yeshiva. Things will be easier for you. You won't have to be born in Tel Aviv, in Dizengoff, or in Las Vegas. That over there nobody will talk to you one word of Judaism until you're 40. Everything is designed based on who you used to be. If you made tshuva before you died, in your next chance it's going to be a lot easier. You have better tools. Why are you, don't you wonder sometimes why Jews live somewhere in Russia 70 years and only once or twice in their life they have a chance to hear something about Jewish things? The Chabadnik gave him tefillin. First time in his life he saw tefillin. Rav Aaron Kotler, Rosh Yeshivat Lakewood, you know, they were about to leave Europe and to cross the border with some goy. Everyone paid the goy. The goy knows the way from the mountains. And they're going to escape. So what happened? All the Jews were ready. Midnight, when it's dark, they have to leave. So they started to walk. After 2 hours of walking in the mountains, Rav Schneor Kotler, he remembered that he forgot his tefillin bag. From all the stress, he was worried about the family, the people of his community. He forgot his tefillin. So he said to the goy, I'm very sorry, I have to go back. The goy told him, by the time you go back and come back, it's going to be morning. We cannot sit and wait for you here. Forget about it, whatever it was. He said, I'm not leaving without my tefillin. So, okay, so you're on your own. So, no, fair enough, goodbye. He went back. He got his tefillin, now it's morning already. He started to walk, the sun is rising now. He saw a farm. He doesn't know Jew, goy. He saw a farm. He has a bag. He come to the farm. He see a goy there. He said to the goy, excuse me, sir, I have to spend some time here. Do you mind if I sit in the back where the horses and the cows are, and I'm going to leave in the evening? I won't do anything. I just want to sit and read my book. The goy looks at him. He doesn't look like a dangerous person. He said, go ahead. He sits there in the back. Then after a few hours, the goy walked in to offer him some food. And he saw him with a tefillin on his arm and in his head. Learning Torah with tefillin on. And talit. So that person looked at him. He got very scared. Wow, who knows now he's going to know I'm a Jew or something. Who knows? So he said to him, what's this? He said, this is a covenant between the Jewish person to God. And we have an obligation to put it every day on the heart. He begins to explain to him and on the soul. He said, I'm also Jewish and I never saw this. The person say, 100% like a goy. Never saw tefillin in his life. So he said, do you want me to put it on for you? At least once in your life you put it? He said, yeah, I don't mind. So he put it for him. He told him, repeat after me. He said, Shema. That's it. 10 years later, he was in the United States. And he was going to meet some rich people to collect money for the yeshiva of Lakewood. And he came to a very stingy man who doesn't want to give. He said, Rabbi, your driver should have told you not to waste time by me. Go to the real generous people. I'm not giving. That's it. That's my nature. So he told him that story. What did he tell him? He told him 10 years after that incident, in the middle of the night, that Jew that I put the tefillin on him came to me in my dream and told me, Rabbi, I want you to know that what saved me in my trial, it was that 10 minutes that you put that tefillin on me, and I agree. You have no idea how much I would suffer if I would say no to you. So he said to him, it's worth it for me to try. You give something. You don't give, you don't give. You give, it changes your entire eternity. There's nothing to compare. You know, used to be a rabbi in Europe, his name Rabbi Chaim Oizer, the chief Ashkenazi rabbi of all Europe. The biggest Talmid Chacham. I believe he lived in Vilna. Rav Michael Lefkovich, still alive, Baruch Hashem, he saw him in his own eyes. He said one time he walked into his room and Rav Chaim Oizer was talking to 12 sofrim. 12 people sitting around the table. He writes 12 different ma'amarim, 12 different articles or books about 12 different subjects from the Torah. He communicates with 12 of them simultaneously. At the same time, he said to this guy, right, Shnayim Ochazim Betalit, this is the opinion, this is that, the Omer Sheli. Then he tells him about 3 or 4 lines. This sofer begins to write. He goes to the next one. You, this, Zvachim, Kodashim, this, completely different subject. He goes to this guy like this, quickly. He does what a normal person does. He does 12 times more at the same hour. And at the same time, he himself writes. And at the same time, there's a person over there with a list of questions in Halacha. And he answered him that. 14 different things. People who knew him said that he was able to write with 2 different hands, 2 different subjects at the same time. You know, one person in the world can do it. You need 2 brains for it. This is Rabbi Chaim Oizer. Rabbi Chaim Oizer, one time he see a boy with his father walking into a shul. He look at the boy. We have 1 yeshiva in town. I never saw that boy in my yeshiva. Where did he come from? Bar mitzvah. He comes to put filin. He said to the father, how come I never saw your son? Where does he go to school? The father said, Rabbi, I send him to public school. Public school? Now we have to understand. In 1970, 42 years ago, 41 years ago, in the United States, the public schools were separate. Boys in one side of the building, there's a wall, and girls are in the other side, they come from 2 different streets. It was separate. They talked about God. Yes, they have JC, they attach him into the budget, but still, they had respect to God. They spoke about respect your parents, you should not steal, you should not kill. Kids got some values. And the rabbis say to people, it's better to die than to send your kids over there. Imagine today when you go, you need metal detector because somebody will stab your son or steal his lunch. That was 2 different worlds. Rav Chaim Oizer told him, this is more than 80 years ago. He said to this man, you're not afraid to send your son to a public school? Please transfer him to yeshiva right away. If you don't transfer him to yeshiva right away, the next time your son will see the Torah will be in 70 years. You're not afraid? Why do I tell you these stories? One time in Petach Tikva in Israel, an old man was called to get an aliyah to the Torah. The old man came to the Torah, Baruchu et Hashem Amvorach, he started to cry, couldn't finish the bracha. Crying, crying, his tears falling on the Torah. The rabbi of the shul in Petach Tikva comes, sir, are you okay? He sat down, he said, I'm sorry, I just broke up. So what happened? He said, I remember the curse that the rabbi gave to my father happened exactly as he said. He said, why? Say, the last time I saw the Torah was 70 years ago, and today it's my birthday. Today I'm 83 years old. Today it's my birthday. The rabbi told my father, if you don't transfer your son to a Jewish yeshiva, next time you will see the Torah will be in 70 years. And it just came to my mind, flashback. That's why I'm crying. So the rabbi of the shul in Petach Tikva asked him, who was that rabbi? He told him, Rabbi Chaim Oizer. So the rabbi of the shul in Petach Tikva collapsed. Started to cry. Now the rabbi is crying. Until now the old man was crying. Now the rabbi is crying. What happened? Rabbi, don't you see what's going on here? What's the name of this shul? Rabbi Chaim Oizer Synagogue. In Rabbi Chaim Oizer Street. In Petach Tikva. 70 years later. Thousands of synagogues in Israel. 70 years the old man didn't see the Torah. Where did Hashem send him to be a guest? In Rabbi Chaim Oizer Street. In Rabbi Chaim Oizer Synagogue. And his birthday, 83 years old. Do you understand how it's going? Ayin Roa, Ve'ozen Shomat, Ve'chol Ma'asecha B'Sefer Nichtavim. There's an eye who watch over you, and there's an ear who listens to you. And everything you do is registered in the book of God. Nobody can run away from Hashem's camera. But we are busy. We're not paying attention, as I said in the beginning. And that's what brings us to have no Yirat Shamayim, no respect to the synagogue, no respect to the Torah. You know, when a person learns Torah, Reuven and Shimon learns Chevruta. All their life, Chevruta. You may think, based on their mutual Torah learning, for the Torah, they get the same reward. For other things that they did, that's a different story. But for the actual learning, every day they learn, I don't know, 5 hours together. These 5 hours, they are learning together. So they have the same reward. Wrong. Wrong. One can get 1,000 times more than his friend. Even though they learned 40 years together, since they're teenagers until they died. How can it be? Reuven and Shimon, he makes 1,000 kilo reward, he makes 1 kilo reward for every hour of Torah. How can it be? First, it depends how difficult it is for your brain to learn. The harder it is, the more reward you get automatically. Second thing, it's what did you give up to learn? Were you a shoeshine in a subway for $7 an hour? Or you were an important doctor who makes $500 an hour? And you left that and you came to learn Torah. It's not the same. Every hour you sit and learn, you're giving up, you're sacrificing at the same time 500. You are paying $500 an hour to learn. Your friend pays $7 an hour. But it's not only that. There's another thing here. What your financial situation when you learn? You have bills. You have creditors are calling from morning to night. Your wife is giving you a hard time. Or you live in a $10 million mansion and you have servants and they do all your errands. It's not the same. If you have nothing to worry about, of course you sit with your pipe and learn Gemara. It's the greatest thing in life. It's very interesting. Why not? $1 million go every month to my account. Why shouldn't I learn? But when I don't know if tomorrow I'm going to be able to pay my rent and maybe in 2 weeks I'll be on the street with my 10 children, it's not as easy. But you give up your life for Hashem, it's not the same. And the last thing is, how much it will take to get you up from the Torah. If now you sit in yeshiva and you're broke, and your friends who learns with you is also broke, and now a builder comes into the yeshiva, guys, I'm looking for workers to help me in my project. How much you paying? $10 an hour. Go get your mother to help you. Leave us alone. We're learning Torah. No, my mother is an old woman. Okay, $15 an hour. No, come on, don't. Wow, we came from Puerto Rico. What's going on here? We are legal American citizens. You know, I just came out of Harvard University. I'm sitting with my tire learning Gemara. You want me to work for $15 an hour? Okay, guys, don't give me hard time. I have to make some money. $20 an hour. Reuven got up. Deal. 2 days he worked. He made $200-$300. He came back to yeshiva. His friend didn't want to come. So then the builder called him an hour later. Listen, don't tell your friend. I'll give you 30. No. 40. No, I need you. Come. $100 an hour for 2 days. No. 120. Okay. Reuven sold Hashem for $20 an hour. Shimon sold Hashem for $120. Who's going to get more reward for every hour that he learns Torah from now on? The one who he took more money to get rid of the Torah, no? The more you're willing to sacrifice, the more reward. You sold me for $20? That's going to be your reward for the Torah. A value of $20. You sold me for $120. Every hour for you count as $120. 6 times more. But there are people, or even $1 million cash, they won't get up. Their reward is eternal. You understand? Eternal. I know some people, they're very, very busy business people. When they come to the yeshiva, they shut their phone. They don't put it on vibration. Vibration every second you read, text, this, that. Excuse me, I have to get up. They shut the phone. And they don't tell anyone when they learn. And then the worker says, hey, Rabbi, it's an emergency. Leave us an emergency number. He say, between 8 in the morning and 12 in the afternoon, I'm dead. You want to contact me in a grave? It's impossible. I'm dead. Rabbi, don't be fanatic. It's an emergency. You may lose $1 million one day if we don't know where you are. Stocks go up, down, to sell, not to sell. The stockbroker. Until 12 o'clock, I'm not here. I'm in the moon. Cannot reach me. No reception there. My cell phone doesn't work. Whatever happened. I take it with happiness. That's it. And 100%. This is people who have big emunah in Hashem. Strong faith. Not like us. Every minute, no? When is the customer going to call? Rashi, what's the Tosfot say? 1 second. Where were we? That's how he learns. Oh, the air condition doesn't work. Let's go to a different place. It's very hard today to learn here. You came to this world to enjoy, to eat, to grow your stomach. Every Pesach in a different hotel. What different car you're going to buy tomorrow? What kind of diamond your wife's going to get tomorrow for her birthday? This is the purpose of your life? Okay, so you live a fake lifestyle. Or you came to this world, Hashem, I'm yours. Where will you want me? You want me in a garbage bag? I'm going to live in a garbage bag. You want me in a big house? I live there, no problem. You want me with a mattress? You want me to sleep on the floor? You know Rav Shach? You heard Rav Shach? You heard about Rav Shach, no? One time Rav Shach was close to 90 years old. He told his driver, Ponovich Yeshiva, I want you to take me to a funeral of that woman. Rabbi, since when you leave the Torah in the middle of the day and go to funerals? You never leave the Torah. He said, it's important. Pouring rain! Pouring rain. They took an umbrella, they drove in a car, they reached the cemetery. You cannot see anything. The car is full of rain. Rav Shach, almost 90 years old, with a crooked umbrella. He came out 2 hours and he went. The driver, he has to go with him. He's an old man. He holds his hand. They go together and he sees that he reads Tehillim under his umbrella. Pouring rain next to the grave of this woman. When it's all over, they got into the car. On the way back, he said, Rabbi, please teach me. What was so important about this woman? So he told him, 75 years ago, I was a teenage in Europe. I was in yeshiva in the time of the war. Bombs are falling everywhere. Airplanes are throwing bombs. In the yeshiva, Half of the people did not have a mattress. Freezing European winter, we had to sleep on the cold floor. I was 16, I'm sleeping on the floor, and I started to think how long I will suffer like this, freezing every night on the floor. My back is breaking. Then I got a letter. I received a letter from my wealthy uncle. My father's brother was a very rich man with no children. He cannot have children. And he has a big factory, millions of dollars in those days, 80, 90 years ago. He sends me a letter, "Dear Eliezer, I have nobody to inherit all my wealth. I want you to come here to live by me in his mansion. And slowly, slowly, I'll teach you to take over the business. It's a shame such a big business will fall into hands of people I don't even know. Come." I'm 16, almost 17. I don't have a mattress. I'm suffering there. And now the letter arrived. I came to the Rosh Yeshiva. I said, "Rabbi, I'm moving. I'm taking my stuff tomorrow. I leave the Yeshiva." I go, he'll show him the letter, my uncle is waiting for me, of course, I'm going to learn there, you know, I love to learn. The rabbi tried to convince him, "Listen, the Torah is more important than money, don't be fooled, it's a trick that the Satan is doing to destroy your eternity." "No, rabbi, you don't know me, I'm going to learn, I know myself. I just want to have a normal bed. I'm tired of this sleeping on a freezing floor with no mattress already for a few years." In the morning, his bag was packed. He's getting ready to go to the train station. A widow showed up with a mattress in her hand. Remember, there was no telephones. She didn't know anything. He was getting ready to leave, so he was the only person outside of the yeshiva. So she came in. She said, "Young guy, can you help me?" "Yeah, what?" He said, "My husband died a week ago. Yesterday we finished sitting shiva. I don't need this mattress anymore. So I thought, I heard someone told me that some of you don't have a mattress in this yeshiva. I want to donate the mattress of my husband to someone here. Do you know anyone who doesn't have a mattress?" He said, "I don't have a mattress for a few years already." She said, "It's yours. Here." My husband was a Talmid Chacham. Be'ezrat Hashem, we will give you bracha. I was holding the mattress. In another hour, I have to be by the train station. And I started to think, this is the difference between a great man to people like us. That we are close to the truth, but we don't really dive inside. We go next to it, always next to it. He started to think. I was about to leave the yeshiva, who knows what's going to happen. I go a different place, I work. It's not the same lifestyle. And Hashem sent me a mattress. Could it be more clear than that? Here I'm here, no mattress. Now today, an hour before I leave, a mattress came to me. I was outside and she handed me the mattress. That means I have no permission to leave. So he took the mattress, he came back, he unloaded his bag and he stayed in yeshiva and became the biggest rabbi in the world. Definitely in this generation. The biggest rabbi of the most important yeshiva in the world. The biggest, he lived 107 years. So he said to his driver, "You know who this woman was? This woman who died today. Now you understand why I'm standing here in the rain reading Tehillim for her? I owe her all my life. Everything I ever have, all my olam haba, I owe this woman. If she would come 2 hours later, that's it, I will be in a train." Please turn the camera. Thank you. That's it. Good. No. Too much. Yeah, good. That's it. Thank you. Now, we'll finish with one thing. Since we mentioned Rav Shach, here in Lakewood, an hour away from here, if you ever go to Lakewood, maybe ask to go to Rav Malkiel Kotler, the Rosh Yeshiva, in his living room, in his wall unit, there is a lot of nice silver things. In between all the silver menorahs, he has a pair of shoes. Very old-fashioned shoes, dust.
reap.
Inside the living room, inside the wall unit. Rav Aaron Leib Steinman, one of the Gdolei Ador, visited Lakewood a few years ago. And he was sitting in the Shabbos table of Rav Kotler. And he noticed those shoes. And he said to him, what do the shoes do inside the wall unit next to all the silver? He told him, I got these shoes from my father, inheritance, who got it from his father, which means my grandfather bought these shoes and passed it in generations, and I will pass it to my children. So he said to him, but what's special about these shoes? He said to him, in the time of the war, bombs were falling next to the yeshiva in Europe. The Rosh Yeshiva came to the guys and said, guys, this was a high school yeshiva. I cannot be responsible for your life. Every day bombs are falling. Who knows what's going to happen next? Please, everyone, go back home. Return to yeshiva when the war is over. All the guys took their bags, took the train, and went home. A week later, when one of the kids, his name is Eliezer, he goes home, he gets home, his mother saw, he came home in the middle of this mud. So what are you doing here? He said, Rosh Yeshiva didn't want to be responsible, so he sent us home. So she said, what kind of Rosh Yeshiva is this? Doesn't he know that learning Torah is the best insurance policy? It's life insurance. Here it's much more dangerous. Go right back into yeshiva. He said, how do I go back? I don't have money for the train. You have money? They were very poor, very poor. Not like today. A poor person today is a millionaire compared to those days. Millionaire. He can afford pizza and Chinese. Well, in those days, what did people had, you think? Nothing. Kids never got $1 from their parents until they become 20 years old. Wasn't like today, vacation, ben hazmanim, Six Flags, take me here, new suit, new hat, hat for Yom Tov, hat for Shabbos, hat for weekdays, special hat for davening, special hat when he's going to Israel, special cover, watch every year. As long as he go like this, when he learn, his father is happy. Well, you want a new car? It was different days. So Rav, this kid, he said to his mother, do you have money for the train? I'll go back. So you know I don't. So what do you suggest? Walk back to yeshiva. He did not ask nothing. Today you tell your son, walk to yeshiva, 10 minutes walk. No, I'm not going. Take me. Okay, take your bike. No. Take your bike, 1 minute. No, take me. He took his big heavy bag and walked 1 week. 1 week from morning to night, 16, 17 hours walk. 7 days, more than 100 hours of walk. Hot, cold. And he arrived to yeshiva. And who was there? The rabbi sitting by himself learning. Dark, bombs are falling. He see Eliezer walked in. Where you got here from? Rabbi, I got home. My mother got very upset. She started to say, what's going on? What kind of yeshiva is this? Sending you back home. The Torah is our life. Better to be dead, not to learn Torah. So I had to come back. She said, so why it took you a week to get here if you decided to come back? He said, I didn't have money for the train, so I walked. He said, you walk all the way from your home to here? Say, yes, it took me a week to get here with a heavy bag, very heavy bag. The rabbi started to cry. He felt so bad. If he only knew that that's going to happen, he would never send him in the first place. So he felt he has to do something for this boy. So he told him, do me a favor. Would you sell me your shoes? I'll give you a lot of money for these shoes. I want to keep these shoes in my wall unit as a sign. What does it mean a lover of the Torah, a lover of Hashem is? And he said, no, Rabbi, here, take them. Here. Gave him a big amount of money. It was enough for a year to live. He took the money and he lived off that money. And he bought that shoes and he gave it to his son, who gave it to his grandson, and these shoes are in Lakewood in a wall unit. Oh. Who these shoes belong to? Russia. Rav Eliezer Manshach became the most important Jew in the world. What do you think? You become Rav Shach with pizza and Chinese every day? What do you think? Vacation, this ben hazmanim, that ben hazmanim. A real Ohev Torah can take ben hazmanim? Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul, my cousin, asked him, Rabbi, which mitzvah you unable to keep? I want to learn. Tell me, there's any mitzvah you cannot do? He was sure he's going to tell him, ואהבת לרעך כמוך. Very difficult to keep this mitzvah. There are mitzvot that are almost impossible. Really almost impossible, especially in these days. Guess what he answered him? Yeah, he said, there's one mitzvah I cannot keep. I don't understand how it's possible to keep it. How can you be a few minutes every day inside the bathroom and not think about the Torah while you're there? I don't know, I can't do it. Every day I fail, I make this sin. Go into the bathroom, I begin to think, Gemara, Rashba, this, Ritba, Rashi, Tosfot. I cannot stop. 1 minute he could not live without the Torah. Facebook, baseball game, this vacation, 2 months in Israel, this. What is this? It's time to wake up. You're either a follower of Hashem and you live according to the truth, or you live in illusion. It's really a shame to become half religious. It's really a big disaster, I'm telling you. Because when a person got all the way to the well and only took one glass, later when there's no water, he suffered more than a person who never knew about the well. Someone who was there and didn't take suffered more than someone who never knew about it. Someone who never knew agreed with his fortune. That's it. What can I do? I have to die. Someone who was there, I always say to people, I feel like a person who you put him inside a wall, inside a room, full of diamonds. Full, thousands of beautiful, fancy diamonds. And they told me, you're allowed to take as much as you can, in one condition. You're not allowed to use bags, boxes, anything. You can use your clothes, you can use your body, you can use your hand, and that's it. So a person who wants to secure his future, the future of his children, what does he do? Quickly, he begins to take diamonds. First, he fills up his pocket to the top. Then he stuffed his shoe as much as he can, right? Then he stuffed under his yarmulke, he put about 50. He puts like this, you know. Then he begins to push in his ears. Then he fills up his mouth. He looks like a balloon now, right? His hands are full, like this. And then he comes out, slowly. He comes out. And then how much he took? 10% of the amount of the diamonds. Now he's out already. When he's out, he can put everything in a bag. That's it. So he puts everything in a bag. Someone like this will be happy or will be upset when he came out of the room?
Upset
that he didn't take more than
10%. Upset. 90% of these diamonds I left there just because I didn't have another ear. Why they made this jacket only with 2 pockets? Full Armani. Stupid Hugo. Couldn't you make 5 pockets? It would be another 10 Rolls Royce for me. Another 5 houses if you make another pocket. That's all he thinks about. Yeah, he became a millionaire. In 40, 50 years, every time he talks about this, he sits like this. What an opportunity. This is us. Sometimes we feel we can do so much more. Like I said to you in the beginning, we can make so many Jews religious. Only all we have to do is to get to them. I promise you, after you watch this film, you understand what I'm talking about. You watch it, you understand. Almost every Jew who watch it, right away, wake up. They're never going to be the same. Never going to be the same. If he blocked his mind before, of course, he doesn't listen. But if he opened to listen, that's it. His life will be changed. But the problem is that we can only get to 1% of the Jews. How are we going to get to all the other 99 Mechalel Shabbos? Eating and kosher, doing merry goyot. We don't get to them. You know why? It's not that we don't have money. The Jewish nation has plenty of money. If the billionaires that we have in our nation, if you put them in one place, you're going to fill up Madison Square Garden. Each share will be a person that has more than $1 billion. I, in my short life, already met more than 20 or 30 billionaires, personally. Billionaires, not millionaires. How much they get for CD? Not even $5,000, all the 30 billionaires together. All they had to do is to give 1% of their wealth, and every Jew in the world will have at least one copy of this Jewish seminar that will teach him God is here. He created the world. He created us. He is watching every second of our life. There's life after life. There is reward and punishment. The purpose of life. The Torah is divine. The oral Torah is divine. 7 or 8 most important thing in history for $1. They won't give. But you tell them tomorrow you want to build another $10 million synagogue, $10 million synagogue. Here is $8 million check to build another fancy temple. Why? The Satan is happy. No, anyway, there's 500 empty synagogues. There's another one. No problem. What do I care? Here it was 500 daveners. Now it's going to be 250 and 250. Another $10 million went to the garbage. Or another habit, Achnasat Sefer Torah, every week. Go to the shuls in Brooklyn, I'll take you to a tour. I will show you in Brooklyn alone more than 1,000 Sifrei Torah that's standing in storage rooms, completely not used, not even a minute a year. And every week, extra 10, 20 books. Achnasat Sefer Torah, and every Sefer Torah, 50,000, 60,000, with some rubies and silver cases, you know, like the Sephardi make. It's very expensive. Just the case is $10,000, $15,000. Depend how you do it, designer, this, that, gold letters. For what? Almost like throwing the money to the garbage. Yes, of course, Sefer Torah. But Hashem is not interested in this. Hashem would be much happier if they take this money and take Jews who have no idea what they live for and wake them up. Wake them up! This is the mission of this generation. Baruch Hashem, you came, you're sitting here for 2 hours, you're listening. That's a sign that you're interested to come closer to Hashem. But don't ever be fooled by people out there that tell you, don't worry, you don't have to be fanatic. Slowly, it's enough, you put tzitzit, you wear your jeans with the holes, baseball hat, this, every day you go to a different baseball game, yeah, you watch television a little bit, you know, just try to watch your eyes as much as possible, it's enough. It's not enough. HaKadosh Baruch Hu is perfect and He expects each one of us to be perfect. How do I know? He wrote it in the Torah to all the generations, include our generation. What does it say? V'asita et kol mitzvotai. Everything, not half, not 70%, everything. That's what I expect from you. And not only that, v'shavta ad Hashem Elokecha v'shamata bekolo. Chazal say, what does it mean, ad Hashem Elokecha? Return all the way to Hashem, your God. Not 80%. If you went from here to LA and you stop after 80% of the road, I don't know, it's 1,000 miles, you did 800 miles. Did you achieve something? You see some people in Arizona, maybe over there, Mexicans making a new highway, and that's it. You didn't reach your destination. This is what the Ramchal writes. Two kinds of Jews, one in the darkness and the other one. But the first one found out he lived in a lie. What he's going to do about it? That's up to your free choice. I would finish with this pasuk that we said in Tehillim and on a Shabbat afternoon in Mincha, the Sfaradim say it when we return the Sefer Torah. Why they put this mizmor in Mincha? Mincha is the most important prayer of the week. Mincha of Shabbat, it's called Ra'ava de Ra'avin, the highest of highest. Lo na'ana Eliyahu Anavi, Ela b'mincha. Mincha, it's an important time before the sunset, especially on Shabbat. And what do we say? We say a mizmor that who wrote? Adam. First mizmor in history. First mizmor in history. First mizmor. Before David HaMelech, before Shlomo HaMelech, before Bnei Korach, before anyone. For Moshe Rabbeinu, as Yashir Moshe. Before everyone, Adam. First Mizmor. Mizmor Shir Leyom HaShabbat. Tov Leodot LaHashem Ulzamer LeShimcha Elyon. What's in the middle of this Mizmor? Don't ever forget what I'm going to tell you now. Ish ba'ar lo yeda. A fool will not know. Uchsil lo yavin et zot. Chsil is complete dumb, worse than fool. Lo yavin et zot. Will not understand this. Will not understand what? Bifroach reshaim kmo esev. That the wicked people are popping from all over like weeds. You leave your garden for 1 week, millions of weeds are coming out. Now go and get rid of them. Worse than cancer. Bifroach reshaim, everywhere you turn your face, millions of goyim, millions of chilonim. Nobody knows what he lives for. Business, money, lying, cheating, all kinds of relation crimes. Ungratefulness, no behaving, no manners, no appreciation to Hashem, nothing. Eating like pigs on the street, all the food is dripping like animals. Millions! Teaching that people came from the monkeys, all they care is about sport and news and nonsense, nothing Hashem. Nothing Hashem! And Adam already told you this, what's going to happen in this world. Bifroach reshaim kmo esev. Vayatzitzu kol poale aven. Everyone who is extremely wicked is higher than everyone. Vayatzitzu. You see them popping up more than everyone else. Vayatzitzu kol poale aven. What's the bottom line? Leishamdam adead. To destroy them for eternity. And this is the words of God. Before I destroy them and cut them from my eternal life, the next world, that's the real world, they have to get for the little that they did. Here mitzvah, here a dollar. Here they made a bracha once in their life. In their bar mitzvah they put tefillin. They did a little bit. A little bit. Once they heard a lecture, maybe they made peace between two Jews. It adds up to a few hundred mitzvot. I owe them a lot. But since I do not want to give them permission to materialize their ticket, every Jew is born with a ticket. But you have to materialize it. The ticket has condition. If you pass the test, La'ativcha b'acharitecha, I will reward you in your end. If you follow my way and keep my mitzvot, you be righteous, I will benefit you in your end. Which end? When you finish your life, the reward will begin. Somebody ever ask you, how do you know there's the afterlife? How do you know there's a reward? This pasuk, La'ativcha b'acharitecha. I am the faithful God who keep my word. And I will reward my righteous children after their end. Which end? The end in here. There's no other end. That's the reward will begin. Everything you had, cars, clothing, food, wife, children, money, watch, whatever you had, it's not even the beginning of the reward. It's not even the beginning. People think, oh, Hashem gave me $1 million on a deal. He likes how I pray. It's an insult. It's an insult. You take this cookie, you make bracha. Hashem already owed you the whole world just for this. King Chizkiyahu didn't want to get married. Hashem sent a prophet to him. Prophet Yeshaya, one of the most legendary prophets we had. He said, get ready, you're about to die. King Chizkiyahu, in case you didn't know, is the most righteous king we ever had in Jewish history. In his generation, every Jewish boy, 6 years old, knew the entire Torah by heart. He took a sword and he said, Jew will not learn Torah, will be stepped to death. I don't need you here. Jews, they had no choice. Everyone became a rabbi. Everyone. And he did not want to get married because he saw in his vision that he's going to have a wicked son. Sometimes you can be a very righteous man and your son is not religious. What can you do? What his son is going to do? To put statues and bring Jews to bow down to Avodah Zarah. Menashe, his son. He said, you know what? I'll die lonely. And I won't get married, not to bring this wicked to the world. He has a vision. We don't know what we're going to get. He has a vision. Hashem got upset. The first mitzvah in my Torah is pru urvu, multiply and have children. Why didn't you fulfill this mitzvah? He said, why? Hashem doesn't know? I sacrifice all my desire. I live all my life without touching a woman. Just not to have this wicked boy, and Hashem complains? I do it for him. I don't want idol worshipping. You're not God. The Torah says to every Jew must have children. The rest is not in your hand. You do your best, and the rest is not in your hand. Yitzchak and Esav, many other important people had kids that were nothing like them. It's not, you did your best, and that's it. So he said to Hashem, okay, Chatati, give me opportunity to correct my sin. The next day the prophet come to him and say to him, no problem. Hashem gave you 15 more years to your life that you can get married and have children. 15 more years. He told him, let me marry your daughter. He married his daughter. Prophet Yeshaya gave him his daughter. He married her. And they had this boy Menashe. And what did he do? He cut his grandfather, the prophet Yeshaya, to slices. He was hiding inside a big tree because he was telling him, not this is what you do is wrong. Hashem will punish you. He got angry. He went, imagine you go to the chief rabbi, he's hiding somewhere, and you take him with a big sword and cut him like cold cuts. Cut him to slices. This is how wicked his son was. But in the end of his life, he made tshuva. He didn't see the end of his life. He saw all the bad things that he's going to do. When Hashem sent the prophet to him to tell him I gave you 15 more years to your life, he said, I don't believe. Prove to me that you're not comforting me. So he told him, today the sun will not go down. If it's supposed to be sunset at 7, 10 o'clock you still see the sun. It's a good sign, no? 10 o'clock the sun is in the middle of the sky. In Iraq, in Babylon, Nebuchadnezzar, the midget, the wicked king, who controlled the whole world, he also see, 10 o'clock, it's still sunny. Let's send someone to the Jews to ask them if they know what happened to their temple, to the Beit HaMikdash. He got a messenger on a horse, he wrote a letter to King Chizkiyahu, to the people of Jerusalem, to the people of Israel, and to their God. Please explain why on this day the sun did not go down in the right time. The messenger was about to leave with the horse. He got up from his chair. He said, wait, I made a mistake. Give me back the ladder. He made 3 steps. 1, 2, 3. He took the ladder. He cleaned the name of Hashem from the end of the sentence and put it in the beginning. He said, that's the right order. First their God, then the king Chizkiyahu, then the people of Jerusalem, then the people of Israel. Not like I did before. And that's the only good thing that he ever did his entire life. Everything else was mass murder, destroying the temple. Only bad things. The Torah say, Hashem paid him for these 3 steps. 70 years he owned, literally owned, the entire earth. The whole world was his. Every person in the world paid him taxes. He occupied the whole world with his massive army, Babylon. You have Babylon everywhere in the United States. It's after him. Every person paid him tax. He was the king of the world 45 years. His son was the king of the world 23 years. And his grandson was the king of the whole world 2 years. All together, this family owned, literally, the own world 70 years. Imagine how many trillions of dollars and pleasures. And everything was in their hand thanks to one time that a person, that Hitler was a little kid compared to him. Make no mistake. For the one time he made 3 steps to give Hashem respect, Goy, he owned the whole world. Now just imagine how much reward you're going to get on a humid Shabbat that you walk 20 years to Shul, and then 20 years back, and then 20 minutes again, and 20 minutes again, and 20, and some people walk an hour in Florida, 100 degrees. I went to Boca Raton, 20 minutes I walk, it's like someone put me in a mikveh with my clothes. Unbelievable! Gehenom in this world! Imagine, 20 minutes back, 20 minutes forth, 3 times, an hour walking. Every 3 steps is 70 years, at least like that guy. He won't get more than me or you. So every 3 steps, 70 years of earth is yours. Now you multiply how much Hashem owed the Jewish nation. That's why the Gemara say the reward of the mitzvot is not in this physical world. Make no mistake that think that Hashem will give you a nice townhouse because you put tefillin. No. What He gives you is some crumbs. Like you have a big massive dough, you take a little crumb and you throw it to the mice to eat. You don't care about it. What's the difference between a Jew and a goy? We say it in a davening when we don't listen. Rabbi, don't be a racist. Don't be primitive. Don't be prejudiced. We are equal. All the people are equal. It sounds very nice. Sounds very convincing. But the Mercedes company made 5 different models. One cost 20,000, one 40, one 60, one 150. Now comes an ignorant person, writes a letter to Mercedes. It's discrimination. Why Mercedes 300 does not cost like Mercedes 500? It's not fair. It's racism. You are prejudiced. It's not fair. What do you mean? I'm the manufacturer. This is an important car, and this is not so important. This is 150. This is 20. There's reason for it, my friend. This diamond is not like this glass. Where does it say it in the Torah? Where does it say in the Torah there's difference between Jews and non-Jews? Where does it say it? It says like this. When a person go to bring water from the well or from the lake, he fill up a bucket, he brings it home, he spill everything into the bucket that he has in his house or the bath, and he has a few drops of water in a bucket, and then he throw it on the side until tomorrow. Tomorrow he's going to take that bucket again to the well, bring more water, put it in the bath, and throw it again. Do you know any normal person, even in the old primitive days that we didn't have faucets in our house, that used to come and leak the water from the bucket? Nobody cares about these few drops. Hashem says like this, for those who understand Hebrew. En goyim kamar midli, ukeshachak moznaim nechshavu. I'll give you another explanation and then I'll explain the whole thing. A person goes to the Israeli market in Tel Aviv, Shuk HaKarmel. They sell vegetables. They all scream, 2 for shekel, 3 for shekel. They kill themselves to make a living. Then you come, you say, I want 1 kilo of cucumbers. 10 cucumbers is 1 kilo. So he put about 10, and then he take a weight, which is 1,000 grams, 1 kilo, and he put it on the other side of the scale. Once the scale is balanced, sir, here, 10 shekel, 1 kilo of cucumbers. I promise you, every time he puts the 1,000 grams on the scale, it's never 1,000 grams. It's not exactly a kilo. It's 999, 998, 997, depend how many years he's using it. Why? Every time he rub it towards the scale, a drop of a crumb is falling off. After 5 years, it's 995. Do you know any normal, stingy person even that will take him to court for the little tiny bite from one of the cucumbers that fell off on the scale? Nobody cares. Hashem said to the Jews, the difference between you, my children, that I chose you and gave you life of eternity for keeping my Torah and I made a covenant with you, the difference between you and all the other nation is that you are the water and they are the few drops that you throw on the side. You are the weight, and they are the one little crumb who fell to the garbage. And you imitate them, such a chatzuf. I gave you everything, and you do everything to be like Vinny and Tony and Ahmed. Baseball hat like this. Ripped jeans with holes. That's a new, how the new things now, Abu Krambi, whatever the name is. Stupid kids fighting with their parents. No, I want this. Why some Vini is wearing it? This kind, all the pants going down, like the Kushim, they bend down. I don't want to tell you what you see.
Abu Krambi can be a good captain.
Abu Krambi.
Abu Krambi.
Jewish, Israeli, and Jewish American kids. All they care about is how can we imitate the goyim more. How can we imitate the goyim more? It's not enough. That's not their name, or no? That's their name, no?
It's called Abercrombie, but Abercrombie sounds
good. Abu Ahmed.
That's what it says, sugar cane is Abercrombie.
Where do you think they make this Abercrombie? Where? In Gaza. Where do you think they make it? In Pakistan. Yeah. Bottom line, ladies and gentlemen, I finished. But I want you, permit, Bezrat Hashem, first of all, I would love very much you take free CDs here. Second, I would like you to log into my website. You have about 1,000 lectures over there. In any subject you can imagine, you have it there. You have the debate that I had with the priest, very entertaining. Ami knows all my lectures, Baruch Hashem. And I promise you, if you search for the truth, you won't leave the website one day, I promise you. Not because it's me, it's because the Torah is very interesting. You just have to know how to present it. And if you know a little bit how to present it, even the biggest fool will not leave the Torah for a second. Why? It's like drug to the soul, not to the body. It's much more important. You cannot live without it. I have a guy, Bradley, in Montreal. He called me up one time. He said, I watched every one of the lecture minimum 3 times. Imagine how many hours, maybe 5,000-6,000 hours he put in it. I said, why do you need 3 times? He said, because the second time I see things I didn't see in the first time, and in the third time I see things I didn't see in the second time. And this is what Chazal say about the Torah. Va'afoch ba, va'afoch ba, ve'kula ba. 100 times you learn the same page in the Gemara, I promise you, every time you see things you didn't see before. It's great, mamash great. I have cards, I'll give you cards. DivineInformation.com. You have plenty of audio, and if you have iPhone, all these things, we put an application over there, you download it, and you can have all the lecture in your iPhone, iPad, iPhone, all their names, whatever you call it. It's right there. Why it's important? Because you need follow-up. One good lecture, it's good to inspire. 2 days from now, nobody will remember this evening, even though Mr. Taharani took care of us like Saudi sheikhs. You know, come to your Torah, you gain another 3 pounds. You know? But maybe in 3 days you remember the pizza and the good beer. But after that, you won't remember the Torah. That's why I always say to the speakers, I say to them, listen, the way you do Kiruv is not sufficient, is not productive. This mellow, I don't know how you want to call it, this very calm down, very, I don't know the right word, I'm afraid to say a word to offend anyone. It's not productive. The way to bring people close to Hashem, it's a combination of love and fear. Love alone, it's worthless. Fear alone is worthless. Each one by itself will not do the job. Hashem say, le'ahava u'le'ira et Hashem. Always it goes together. You show the beauty of the Torah. You show the huge reward. The Torah says, if you take all the pleasures of all the people of all the generation, all of them from the beginning of the world to the end of it combined, will not be equal to the reward that I'm going to pay to one righteous Jew for 1 hour. 1 hour in heaven of a righteous Jew is already better than all the pleasure of trillions of people all their life combined. You understand what we're about to lose? For a stupid baseball game on Shabbat? Or some non-kosher nonsense that we eat? How much to lose? You know how much you jeopardize? So to show the love, it's very important. To ignore the punishments, half of the Torah, it's punishments. Severe, very serious punishments. Just not to enter the world to come. Can you imagine a worse punishment than that? You're supposed to go to trillions of years of pleasure and Hashem say you out. Why? You mechalel Shabbos. Why? You walk half naked on the street and all the men is looking at you. You are not welcome in my world. I hate problems with modesty. I'm holy. I gave you an opportunity to be modest. You went naked on the street. You are not welcome here. Just think about it. Forget about hell. Forget about all the things. Forget about it. Imagine it wasn't exist. Just not to enter. You know what a disaster? You know what? agony, what pain, what disappointment a person is going to have. Don't you read in the Torah? The Torah, every word is divine. I'm testing you every second to see what's in your heart. Are you with me or are you against me? Are you motivated? You're learning? You're improving? All you care about is to eat and to drink and who knows what, and nothing else. If you're on the way up, it's great. You know, I have a very good friend. His name is Rabbi Fanger. Everybody knows him. He's on the internet. He's the number one star in Israel in Judaism today. He's on the television 20 hours from 24 hours that the Israeli channel broadcasts him. He's there. He's on the internet, on the radio. He has hundreds of thousands of followers. And I had the schut to do, I think, five seminars with him altogether. A few in New York, in L.A. And one time, we were in L.A. There's a seminar of more than 500 people. There is mostly Israelis. There's about 100 or more Americans that don't speak Hebrew. So it's a combination. There was me, him, and Brother Man. I'm the only one who speaks English, so I have to do the Hebrew and the English lectures. Now it's Shabbos afternoon. We're eating Seudah Shlishit. And we sit in a table and we talk. So I told him, Yitzhak, I want to tell you something. Here is my advice to you. You want to take it? Fine. You don't want to take it? Ignore it. You are charismatic. You're funny. You're a great actor. You're knowledgeable. You know, you're sweet. People enjoy to listen to you. The numbers do not lie. I want to give you an advice that will make you a lot more productive. Isn't it everything we're doing is to make Jews religious? That's the whole purpose, no? To be stand-up comedy or to be an actor on stage, it's not the purpose. The purpose is not the car. It's the purpose where you're going to head to. I gave you a car, you have to get to L.A. To get to L.A., it's the purpose, not the actual car. People forget the purpose. So I told him, now we're going to give a lecture about Shabbat. You're going to do it in Hebrew, and I'm going to do it in English. Two things you must say in the lecture. You must. Don't be afraid. So yeah, go ahead. I say you have to tell them that according to the Torah, the Ten Commandments go from the most important to the least important mitzvot. The first one is, I'm your God. Obviously, without this, there's nothing. Second one, do not dare to have another God. I'm the only one. Third one, don't swear or disrespect my name. And all three is really one. And what's the first one, really, which is the fourth, but is really the second one? It's Shabbat. Shamor et Yom HaShabbat. Observe my Sabbath is an eternal covenant between me and the Jewish nation for eternity. To know I created the world in 6 days, and in a 7 days I rested. Now, you have to make sure that they understand that according to the Torah, the punishment of a Mechalel Shabbat, a Jew who does not observe the Sabbath, is much worse than the punishment of a Jewish murderer. You must make sure they understand it, because these kind of people have no idea what Shabbat is. They think it's a joke. They think it's a day to rest. You want to take it. You don't want to ignore it. You have to make sure to shock them to understand. Now, I looked at him, he almost cried, because it's not his nature. It's very nice, soft, nice. His nature, it's very hard for him to be tough. And he said, what's the second one? I say to him, the second one, you have to understand, we have to understand that a person who's not keeping Shabbos, Hashem said in the Torah, that is 100% a goy in my eyes. Arehu kegoy lechol davar. If he touched the wine, cannot do kiddush on it. If he's a witness, the testimony is canceled. If he took a loan, you're allowed to charge him interest, but you're not allowed to charge other Jews. If he died, you don't bury him with Jews. You have to bury him in a different section. He cannot be buried with Shomrei Shabbat. He knows all the laws. I say, you have to make sure they understand it. He told me, you sure? They get scared. I told him, trust me. Everything else, they'll remember for a day or two, and that's it. These two things, they'll remember forever. I promise you, this is the nature of a person. He said, okay, I'll try. He went to his side. I went to my side. It's recorded. It's going to be in my website. If you don't believe it, I'll give you his cell phone number in Israel. You call him tomorrow and ask him. Or tonight. It's going to be morning there. Ask him if every word I say here is true or not. 100%. Rav Yitzchak Fanger from Israel. An hour later, I finish my lecture. He finished his lecture. Here we meet again in Melava Malka. Motzei Shabbos, another meal. Braverman play guitar. They brought sushi. Everyone is stressing. And me and him sitting in a corner in a round table. And now they give the microphone to all the participants on that seminar. What do you think? What do you have to say about the seminar? It started on Thursday. Now it's Shabbat after Shabbat night. It's already more than 2 days of lectures. Everyone say how they enjoy, how inspiring, beautiful. Then they come to a woman, a very fancy Israeli lady, with a very rich husband, is a major builder in LA. They live in a big mansion, huge mansion like the size of this whole street here. And the husband is Shomer Shabbat for 2 years already. And she's not Shomer Shabbat, the wife. She gets the microphone, she was the last one who spoke. And she said, I want to say something. My husband has been begging me for a while to keep Shabbat with him. And I ignore all this begging. Every Shabbat I take the car with my friends and we go here, we go there. My husband goes to shul, he comes, he eats by himself, and I go with my friends. From one side, my husband is begging me to keep Shabbat. From the other side, my father from Israel, every week, my daughter, Shabbat, Shabbat, Shabbat. I hear it for years. And I heard many lectures of all the speakers. And nothing ever made me even consider keeping Shabbat. But today, I want to tell everyone that I'm accepting on myself 100% to be a Shomer Shabbat forever. Two things Rabbi Fanger said in his lecture shocked me. First one I told him, and the second one I told him, she said it. He looks at me, he almost fainted. I look at him smiling. He said, wow, I can't believe it. What a siat d'ishmaya, what a miracle. I told him, no miracle, no nothing. This is the Torah of Hashem. To love and to fear me, I'm not your friend from high school. I give you oxygen, don't be ungrateful. I gave you everything you have, you should appreciate it. I gave you a set of mitzvot and sin not to do, restriction, rewards and punishment. I was very serious about what I wrote in my Torah. You want to take it, you don't want to leave it, you pay the price. Nowhere in the Torah a person has a free choice. We have a choice, but it's never ever been free. Don't make that mistake. There is a choice. You want to keep it? Fine. You don't want? Also fine. Nobody puts a gun to your head. In the end, I'll calculate what I owe you or what you owe me. In the end, you have to pay. You took a credit card that you got today in the mail. You went shopping all day, all week, all month. The bill comes in the end of the month. $15,000. Where will I pay it? Interest, penalty. In Israel, the police come to your home. Hotzah lapoal. Here in America, you change your name. Every day, 10 news. Call! Bankruptcy laws are about to be changed. Contact us today. It's a place of crooks. Foundation of this country is all based on lie. But the Torah is not like that. In Israel, you don't pay. They come and break your glasses in your face and take your refrigerator for home. There's nothing you can do. They come with a court order. Ah, now you are feeling the pleasure of the shopping 2 weeks ago. The stupid jeans you bought, how much it costs now. And it's growing and growing. They take away your home for jeans. You think I'm exaggerating? 1,000 shekel can become a million shekel in 20 years. 1,000 shekel! A suit! Become a house. In Israel, it's a killer. It's not like here. Okay, no, pay some, we'll forgive it. We'll clean it from your credit report. In Israel, you're 20 years, you have grandchildren, they still come every week. They take your couch. They take the chandelier that worth $5 from Shuka Pishpishim in Israel. They take the tires of your car if they can. They don't leave you alone. And it's nothing compared to how strict Hashem is in the afterlife. What do you think? It's a joke? You owe a dollar, you're going to pay it, my friend. It won't help you, the bankruptcy that you cheated Chris and Ahmed and you didn't pay them. You still owe them according to Hashem rules. Over here, they could not do anything. The American court gave them a stamp. Kosher thief. But Hashem never signed on that certificate. It's still open. And this is what I'm telling you today. Believe me, it doesn't pay. Believe me, trust me, the truth is the truth. It doesn't pay. It's better to be righteous today, not tomorrow, tonight. You go to sleep, Shema Israel, you talk to Hashem in your own language. Help me out. I heard a lecture, I got inspired. Show me the way, show me the right teacher, show me the right place to learn Torah. Get me someone to help me. I want every day, I want to keep Shabbat. I want to call Amram. Amram, can I come to you for Shabbat? Help us out. We want to know, we don't know how to do it. Of course he's going to say, come, I'll be very happy. Him, his father, I'm sure. Not him, he's not the only one. There's a lot of Shomrei Shabbat here. Aviel. Your house is open for them, no? Anytime. Here, you have Ami here, you have Aviel, you have Amram Tehrani, no, who else here? Yeah, there's plenty, Baruch Hashem. They cover everyone. But you got to do it. Imen Anili Mili, nobody will do it. Nobody do it for you. Thank you very much again. Hope to meet you again in the future.